some reason, I got the title of the course and the number of the course wrong on Tuesday. So the course is 669, and it's mechanical properties of steels and not ferrous alloys, luckily. So there were some issues where people told me they couldn't register for the class. Has that been solved? Because there apparently only 10 people were able to register. Has everybody been able to register? Okay. And then Tuesday's introduction and today's lecture should be on E-class, POFAS, if you want to have the material available. Okay, so today will be when we talk about fundamentals, what we're basically going to do is we're going to look at what does mechanics tell us about elasticity and plasticity. We won't go into the theory because if you want to go through the theory, you just take courses on mechanics. But what we'll do is see how it applies to steels in real life, and see how we apply it in real life. So just a reminder to start with elasticity, what you're basically dealing with in a steel on the atomic level, you have a solid that is defined, that hangs together through the metallic bond, right? Metallic bond is something very specific, yes? It's different from the ionic bond, from covalent bond, yes? And in steel, and in particular in ferrite, yeah, the way you should think about it is that you basically have ions of iron, yes? And then you have electrons that cause the metallic bond. Right? So we won't go into the quantum mechanics of it all, but iron is a transition metal, yes? And the way it works is you have basically ions of iron, yes, which miss a couple of electrons because they share these electrons with all the other atoms. And these electrons are actually 4s free electrons that form kind of a gas. Yes, they're not localized, they're delocalized. And then in iron, specifically ferrite, you have closer by, yes, still forming a cloud, yes, are the 3D electrons. And then all the other electrons are basically on their original atomic levels, as if nothing had been going on with them when the bond was created, going from atom to the solid. And you have a solid core, right? So this is, and then if you prefer this picture here, yes, what you have for ferrite, you have your unit cell here, yes? A unit cell, little cube here. If you count the number of atoms in this unit cell, you have two iron atoms. In the solid, you basically have two ions, iron ions, and you have these delocalized 4s level free electrons here, and you have about four of these electrons per cube, yes? Okay, so basically meaning that every iron atom contributes two electrons to the electron gas. Mm-hmm. So you can, you know, just from this simple picture, there are about 10 to the 17 times 10 to the 20 second electrons per cube centimeters of free electrons in your solid. Okay, so. So what happens, yes, is that when you have the metallic bond is created, you also have a specific distance between the atoms. Yes, this atom, and you have this distance is set by the interactions between the electrons, the interactions between the ions, and the interactions between the ions and the electrons, right? And obviously, for instance, if I'm trying to push these two ions towards each other, you know, if I push them too close to each other, their very large positive charges will push them apart. Yes. Okay. So it comes as no surprise that when we look at the energy of your crystal, yeah, you find a minimum. Yes. Yeah, so this is energy at a specific density of atom or interatomic distance. And so this is a calculation which is done first principle, so-called DFT calculation, for alpha ferrite at 0K and for austenite at 0K. And what you see is that there is a minimum here, minimum where the which will basically define what the interatomic distance is in your crystal, and at that minimum you also have a certain energy, and you see that the energy of the ferrite is lower than that of the austenite, the FCC lattice, and as a consequence what we see at room temperature also is the stability of ferrite rather than austenite. Yes, there is a profound reason for this, which is very complex, and which is related to the magnetic properties of ferrite and austenite. Austenite does not have apparent visible magnetic properties, but they exist, and that causes the ferrite to be the more stable phase at room temperature. Okay, and so let's get on with things. So you know that there is a certain equilibrium distance between the atoms, and if I bring them closer together, they will be repulsed by each other. If I take them too far apart, they will have a tendency to come back together. So in other words, you can think of all this bonding stuff as if the atoms were connected with some kind of springs. Yes? And there's something interesting. This function which describes this this behavior of the energy of the crystals as I pull the atoms apart or push them back together is called an interatomic potential. Yes? And it has this kind of shape here. Yes? And people have been calculating this for iron, for many other solids, yes? Because, for instance, if you want to do very big calculations of atomic processes, like, for instance, in molecular dynamics, you need to have this function, yes? You need to know what happens when you move an atom closer to another one. You know, what will this atom do? It will change its position. One of the very simple things you can illustrate with this interatomic potential is for instance, thermal expansion. Why do solids expand when you increase the temperature, for instance? Well, if they do this because this interatomic potential is asymmetric, yes? So, for instance, if we at 0K, the if you look at this potential energy curve here, the atoms will be sitting at this specific distance here, a specific distance here, which is the minimum. Yes, as you increase the temperature, the crystal starts to vibrate. The atoms springs are being pushed together, strained, pushed together, as a result of what we called quantized lattice vibrations, which we called phonons, yes? And the amplitude of this vibration increases. So the atom vibration goes from here to here, yes? And from here to here as you increase the temperature, from here to here as you increase the temperature. And so what you see happening, because this well is asymmetric, you see that the mean value, or the middle value, as it were, of the atomic position increases. Yes? So thermal expansion is due to the shape of this interatomic potential. It doesn't always have to be. You have solids which contract with when you increase the temperature, or that do not expand when you increase the temperature. There's actually a very famous iron alloy called Invar, which has this property. And the reason why it you have negative or no thermal expansion is again due to special magnetic properties in the case of steel, that Invar. And there are anorganic solids which actually can contract with temperature. But that's not of our concern today. So, well, let's look at one of these interatomic potentials, yes, of these functions. So this is an actual one here. So you have actual EVs here, yes? And you see here, this is your minimum. And there, the function increases, and the potential energy becomes goes to zero as you have very long distances, yes? In this particular iron potential that I've taken from the literature, it shouldn't be of any concern to you at this stage. The minimum value for the interatomic density is 0.262 nanometers. Yeah? And that's very close to the, for instance, the iron-iron distance of 0.248 nanometers in the 111 direction between the two iron atoms. That's in that lattice, that's the distance of closest approach, okay? Right, so if we have a potential energy function like this, right? So this is a potential energy, right? So this is an EV, yes? And if I take the derivative of this function, yeah? So as to x, so this is EV, and these are nanometers, yes? And EV is energy. It's like work, yes? So work is say, force times distance. So newtons per nanometers, yes? And this is nanometer. So when I take the derivative of a potential function, I find a force, right? Okay, so the derivative of this interatomic potential allows me to determine right away what is the force that I will experience when I push the two atoms together or pull them apart, yeah? At this point, or any point actually of this function, yeah? So I'm interested in this, because it tells me something about these springs that connect the atoms. And of course, that will tell me, if I know the spring constant, it basically, as you know, is nothing else than an elasticity constant if I use Hooke's law. And so the derivative of a function like this, well, let's have a look at how it goes. So here, when I increase the x, I decrease the y, so it's negative, yes? Here it's zero, yeah? So here it's zero, so yeah? And here it's in this direction, so when I increase the x, I also increase phi, so it's positive. So around this point here, this function goes like this. Okay? Right, so, and this is shown here. So I have, this here, yes? This is the potential is here, right? Oops, let me go back. This is the derivative to the potential, right? Okay, so that's an EV per nanometers. It's a force. And what I'm going to do now is to make the math nice and elegant. I'm going to fit a sine fit to this derivative. You see, this derivative has this shape here. You see, eventually it has this shape, right? So this part of the derivative, I'm going to fit a sine through it so I can do elegant math rather than any profound reason. I know this, so I can calculate this the derivative, no problem. So there is this particular point here where the derivative reaches a maximum. That's at about 4.5 EV nanometers, and it's at the distance of about 0.3. Okay. So what I do now, I fit the sign to the derivative of the interatomic fluid. That gives me this force, and the atomic. What we should always remember is these are very, very tiny distances, right? So we can linearize whenever we feel it makes life easier. Yeah. So the distance from the equilibrium position, yeah, so x minus L0 is very small. Anyway, so this function that we decide to use is f max times sine pi the delta x divided by 2L. Okay, and now we assume that this is that we stay very close to this point, yes, and so we linearize. Yeah, we make it so that means we get this, right? And then we have a force, so we're going to define a stress. The problem with defining a stress is here I have to divide by a certain surface, and I choose in this case, and I don't have many strong arguments for doing this other than it's reasonable. We use L0 square as the area over which I will have that force work. So that gives me a stress, okay? Stress is force divided by surface area, and so if I put this, use these two things together, this is what I get. Right, and now I'm going to rearrange the formulas so that it looks like Hooke's law. And Hooke's law is, as you know, looks like this. Stress is modulus times strain. Okay? Okay, so I'm going to then say, well, the strain is the difference I pull the atoms apart divided by their original distance. Yes, that's a good definition of the strain here. And then all the other factors I put together. And that becomes my modulus. All right, so this is the modulus. Then, and then I plug in all the data points that I have. Yes, so I have the F max from the previous slide. Pi is pi, of course. L is this larger distance, 0.3, yes, which came, rolls out of the derivation, and L0 is, so this is L0 here, yes, and this is L. So I have, as soon as I know the interatomic potential, I have all these things, and I can guess, just from having the interatomic, what my elastic modulus will be. And for iron, yes, and I find 101 gigapascal. 101 gigapascal. So it's a little bit on this. We'll see, because we'll see some data here. It's a little bit on the low side. It's reasonable, but obviously a little bit simplified. Okay. So remember, we're working now, we're thinking about elasticity, so we're thinking on the atomic scale here, yes? So we'll just focus to make the to make full use of the advantages of simplifying the elasticity stress strain curves by making use of the symmetry of the crystal, I'm just going to focus on the unit cell. And let's say I have a unit cell here, and some way or another, I have normal stresses in this direction, and I also have some these red shear stresses. Yeah? Okay, so the question is now, can I apply Hooke's law, the one you know from mechanics? Yes, this is the law you're familiar with from mechanics. Yes, can I apply this to my single crystal? Yes, and the law you've learned in your undergraduate work, which looks like this, where E is the so-called Young's modulus, and this parameter here is Poisson's ratio, nu, yes? And the sigmas and taus are tensile and shear stresses, and the epsilon and the gammas are tensile and shear strains. Yeah? Can you apply this to this single crystal here? Well, you can't. You can't because many crystals, and iron definitely, is not isotropic. So you, in principle, and I'll come back to this in a moment, in principle, you really can't use this. You should be using this one, this Hooke's law. And so if you compare these two, you see, well, it kind of looks a little bit similar, except that instead of having here, for instance, 1 minus nu or here nu, I've got these odd C values, okay? And so these C values are called the elastic constants of the crystal or the stiffness constants of the crystal. And you can determine them just like you do determine all the elements in this matrix here by experiments. Right? So if you do that, yes. First, before I say something, you can express the just like you do for isotropic you can express the your Hooke's law for single crystals as stress as a function of strains, or you can express your strains as a function of strength. Yeah? And the matrix look similar, yes, but the parameters in them are different. And here, whereas here you talk about elastic constants and stiffnesses, here you'll talk about compliances. Yes, and they're dimensions. Whereas the C's are in gigapascals or pascals, the S's are in reciprocal pascals. Okay. Right. So. I will say a few things about this, how you determine these C values and S values. But if you know these elastic constants, the C11s, C12, and C44, yes, and they're shown here, 237 gigapascals, 141 gigapascal and 116 gigapascals, yes, I can easily calculate the compliances, yes, and if I know the compliances of a crystal, I can very easily calculate the elastic constants, yes. These are the equations that are given to us by elasticity theory of single crystals. Okay. All right. What do these quantities mean? What should you think about these quantities? All right. So when we say C11, how would you measure this? Yes. Well, it's related to, if you have your single crystal, yes, and you stress it in along a main axis, along a cube axis, like a 1-0 direction, a 1-0-1 direction. Excuse me, 0-0-1 direction, yes? You will have a specific strain, yes? Okay? And the relation between the stress and the strain in that particular direction, yes, gives you this C11 value, yes? C44 is related to shearing of the same crystal. So if you do shear experiments and you look at the amount of shear you get in the single crystal as a function of the shear stress, yes, you can determine C44. C12 is a little bit more complex to measure. And there is one parameter that we'll be discussing a little bit more detail in a few moments. That is the compressibility, or the inverse of the compressibility, the bulk modulus. So if I apply to this crystal a certain pressure, yes, you can actually make this crystal smaller, yes, in general, the reduced lattice parameter, and there is a relation between the amount of pressure you give and the volume strain. Okay? So the amount of pressure you give, the volume strain, yes, the relation between these two is the bulk modulus. I personally, always get a little bit confused when, what's the bulk modulus, yes? It's much easier to use compressibility, yes? Yes? That's the K value, and that's actually the volume the amount of volume shear, the volume strain, when you increase the pressure. This is volume strain over pressure increase. Yeah? But that's the compressibility. Yeah? We like it to be a positive number, so we say minus, right? Put a minus sign just so that compressibility is a positive number, because if I increase the pressure, this one will decrease. So if I put a minus sign, it becomes a positive number. Well, so the bulk modulus is nothing else than the reciprocal of this compressibility. And what is interesting is that these three parameters that we've seen, the C11, C12, C44, these three elastic constants, yes, which appear in Hooke's law for single crystals, yes, yes. Once you know these three, yes, you can determine all the other ones, yes, bulk modulus, compressibility, Poisson ratio, whatever, yes, because those are the three only independent parameters of elasticity. Okay, so it comes as no surprise then if compressibility can be expressed in terms of the these modulus values C11 and C12. Again, I'm not going to go into the elasticity theory here, which would be just number crunching, and see in a moment that it's not worth the effort in the case of steels. All right, so compressibility, and of course, if I have the inverse, I get 3 C11 plus 2 times C12 divided by 3 for the bulk modulus. All right? Just a few things here for those who may not know this, but it's kind of interesting a thing to know when you are thinking about expansion or compression of a iron crystals is that there is always a relation between the linear expansion of your steel iron lattice and its volume expansion. And if we assume that we're looking at a situation like hydrostatic stress or thermal expansion, yes, where the lattice expands, you can show that's a very simple relation between the amount of volume strain you have and the amount of linear strain you get. So if you look, for instance, at your unit cell here, iron BCC unit cell, and let's keep one atom in place, yes? And just let's assume we're looking at thermal expansion to make things. Yes? So then the atoms will move further away from their equilibrium position just a little bit, yes? And you'll have a volume change. But you will also have a change in a linear change in this direction, right? There's a very simple relation between this volume change and the linear strain or change, yes, is that the volume strain is three times the linear strain. And this is shown in very simple equations that show you this. The linear strain is 1 over L, which would be 1 over the lattice parameter, times dL dt. That's assuming that we're looking at thermal expansion in this case. So that is the value, that's the thermal expansion. That's how you would measure it, yes? And the volume strain is 1 over V dV dt. And so if you look at, if you replace in the formula for beta, you replace V by L to the third, yes? You find this derivative, yes? And you can show that the volume expansion, the value, the numerical value is three times the linear expansion of the crystal. Or if you compress, the same thing would happen in compression. Right, so well, let's just, you see something about the use of this equation, what kind of number you put in, and you know, where do these, you know, what do you do with these parameters? So let's say you have, we're looking at compressive, hydrostatic compressive stresses, yes? We apply it to a single crystal of iron, yes? And we want to have a volume change of 10 to the minus 6, a volume minus, yes, that's the volume change we want, yeah? Okay? And we know what the elastic constants are, C11, C12, C44. So the question is, you know, how much should the pressure be, in other words? Yeah? So of course we know, we're looking at single crystal, yes? We know a lot about the strains, yes? And we also know that there's no shear stresses involved in this situation, or you know, there's just a pure volume change. There's no shape change. So and I take the axis for the stress and the strains along the cube axis. So epsilon 11, epsilon 22, epsilon are equal, yes, and they're equal to minus 10 to the minus 6 here, yes. And so if I use this, I find that the strains, are 1/3 of this value. Okay, and now I simply apply this my Hooke's law for the hydrostatic compression. So I have sigmas, and here I have my epsilons. They're all the same, and here I put in my C11s and C12s. Yes. Okay. right? And so this tells me what sigma 1-1 is. Sigma 1-1 is 230 times this, plus 134 times this, plus 134 times this, right? And also sigma 2-2 and sigma 3-3. And P is simply, if I use these numerical values, yes, taking into account to change the gigapascals into megapascals by writing 10 to the third times megapascal, I find here 1.64 megapascal. Okay? Right. Alternatively, you can use the concept of compressibility or bulk modulus to get an idea of what the relation will be between the reduction in the volume and your hydrostatic pressure. So let's apply this. I just told you that the compressibility is not an independent elastic property, so we can calculate its value. It's 3 divided by C11 plus 2C12. So if I put in these numbers, this is the parameter, this is the value of the parameter. And if I calculate B, the bulk modulus, it's a reciprocal of this, yes? And I find 173 gigapascal. Remember that number? We'll use it in a little in a moment. So say how much will the volume be if I have a hydrostatic pressure of 5 gigapascal? Well, I apply here the equation for the compressibility, and I find 2.9%. Yes. Okay. And if I use the relation between volume strain and linear strain, it also tells me that there will be about a 1% contraction on linear scale. All right. So 3% contraction in volume, a 1% contraction on the linear scale. Well, that's kind of interesting. Do people actually do these funny things? I mean, really, seriously. Well, yes, they do. There are people who actually take iron and they increase the hydrostatic pressure. And they go much further than 1 or 5 gigapascals. They go to huge amounts of hydrostatic pressures. And so what happens when the hydrostatic pressure changes, as increased? Yes? You're pushing the atoms closer together. Yes? And other crystal structures become more stable. So if you reach at room temperature, about 11 gigapascal, it's considerable, very considerable pressure. Yeah? You turn your alpha iron into a hexagonal form of iron called epsilon iron. Yes. And if you increase the temperature, yes, for instance, if you are at say above 900 degrees C, you do the same thing. You have, at that time, you have austenite. You increase the pressure. At about 30 gigapascals here, yes, you turn your austenite again in epsilon iron. Yes. Why would anybody do this? Who is interested in kind of, well, there's some people who are interested in planetary science. Yes. And you know what happens inside planets? Inside planets, you have huge gravitational forces, huge pressures, and also extreme temperatures. And it's very well possible that the Earth, which consists of a central ball of some kind of ferrous alloy, probably iron nickel, yes? The in those parts of the inner structure where the pressure and the temperatures are extremely high, we actually have this form of iron being stable, yes? In order to do these experiments, you need to be very advanced experiments where you have extremely high pressures and you use what's called diamond anvil tests, where you basically pressurize your sample iron very high. You can achieve very high pressures, so the sample is tiny, yes, but you must also be able to study it, yeah, so you must be able to determine the crystal structure as you do this extreme high pressure, yes. That's why if you use diamond, you have very high, very strong tools, and you can get these very high hydrostatic pressure, and you can actually observe these transformations. The reason why you go from alpha to epsilon is because the atoms are much closer to each other. The atomic density is much higher in the epsilon, the hexagonal structure. And also, the reason why austenite eventually becomes epsilon is also because the density, atomic density in epsilon is slightly higher, than in gamma iron. All right. But let's come back to Earth. The main topic of the course is actually steels. So, and I've been talking about past three quarters of an hour about single crystals of barite. What can we say about the elastic constants of iron? Yes. Well, first of all, there is a big temperature effect. There is a temperature effect. Your elastic properties change with temperature, so they're different at room temperature and at minus 40, yeah, which is, as you remember, a temperature it's cold, but it's Earth temperature, and plus 50, yeah, which is warm, but yeah. And there are many applications where we use steels at very much higher temperatures, and power plants, 500-600 degrees C is not abnormal, right? So temperature is important, and so your constants will be influenced by the temperature. We never use pure iron. Most of our steels are 95% of iron, but they're not pure, and the alloying has an impact. The crystal structure has an impact. Some of our alloys are ferritic steels, other alloys are austenitic steels. They don't have the same elastic properties. You know that ferrite is ferromagnetic at room temperature, that it isn't at higher temperature. There is a small but noticeable effect of the ferromagnetic transformation on the modulus, or on the elastic properties. And then, we use polycrystals. We deform them all the time, yes? What happens to the elastic modulus when you have a piece of steel that you've measured the elastic modulus, and then the same piece of steel has been deformed, and what is the elastic modulus the same? Well, if you measure it, yes? Well, no, it's not. It's changed because we have introduced crystal defects. In particular, when you deform metals and steel, you generate lots of dislocations. We already talked about this, but you also generate point defects, like vacancies. And then, very often also, when we deform materials, we create preferred orientations, yes? So, is it worth all to focus on these single crystal properties? Okay, that's the question. So first, let's have a look at our the impact of the temperature on the modulus, yeah? So on the elastic constants, so the C11, C12, and C44, the change with temperature. This is a very nice, you know, if you ever need to have an idea of change of your parameters as a function of temperature, this is a nice empirical relation that you could use. So you want the value of the Cijs at a certain temperature. You use the values at 0 degree Kelvin, which are given here, yes? And then you subtract this parameter here, temperature dependence parameter, S divided by exponential TE over T minus 1. T is the temperature at which you measure. S is a parameter. And TE is also a parameter, yes, that you get from this table. Yeah? So that allows you to fit, for instance, this data here. And you see C11 as a function of the ratio of, this is TC, is the Curie temperature divided by T. And you see this reduction of C11, C12, and C44 in function of the temperature. So the equation I just showed you allows you to calculate this at any temperature. Very useful. You see that all these parameters soften, yes, as you increase the temperature, yes? And you also see here that there is a little anomaly at TC, TC being the Curie temperature. That's the temperature below which the ferrite is ferromagnetic and above which it's non-magnetic or diamagnetic. And you see that there is a reduction of the stiffness when we cross the transition in terms of C11. But there is an increase in the modulus in the C12 modulus, okay? So slight effects, but you should be aware of them if you ever come across this. Hmm? Elastic properties are influenced by composition. You can see this here. These are the parameters for alpha iron, yes? And these are the parameters for three stainless steels, yes? First one, let's focus on the first one, because there I have single crystal values. Yes, you can see that I get different parameters. Yes, C11, C12, and C44 parameters. They're not very different, but there is a difference between alpha iron and this stainless steel single crystal, which is due to two things. A, the fact that we have another crystal structure, and the fact that we have a other composition. And we'll come in a moment about, you know, if you have to do calculations, what kind of formulas can you use? Right, so one of the things you see in general is if you look at the modulus, yes, the modulus, if you assume that your steel, your alpha iron is isotropic, you see that the modulus of the ferrite, both the elastic modulus, Young's modulus, and the shear modulus is slightly higher in the ferrite. So you have a slightly stiffer lattice in the ferrite compared to the austenite. The single crystal parameters, C11, C12, yeah, C44, allow you to calculate all the other parameters, yes, in any direction. Were you ever to have to determine elastic constants like the modulus, Young's modulus, of larger crystals, iron crystals. Hmm? So for instance, one of the things that is of interest is, for instance, you want to know what is the modulus, the Young's modulus, if I make a an experiment with a single crystal, yes, of iron, yes, and I want to know what will be my modulus. Well, I can use this equation here to calculate the modulus, Young's modulus, in any direction, yes, using, again, these three independent elastic constants, C11, C12, and C44. And this parameter here, L1 square, L2 square, L2 square, L3 square, plus L3 square, L1 square. And what is it? This is a parameter that is a geometrical factor, which is related to the orientation in which you are measuring. Yes? And this is called the L values here are the so-called direction cosines. Yes? So they're basically the cosine of the angle that that direction makes with the cube axis of your single crystal. So for instance, if we're looking at 110, yeah, direction, and we want to have to know the Young's modulus of this direction, then, first thing you do is you determine L1, L2, and L3. And you, the simple way to do this, it's the cosine of the angle between in the case of 110 direction is, for L1, is the cosine of the angle between 100 and 110. So you know if I do this, the product, dot product of these two, yes, I find this value, and that is equal to the length of 100 vector and the length of the 110 vector, so these are these two square root terms, times the cosine between those two directions. So everything is known here, so I can determine what L1 is. It's cosine alpha, and if you do this, you find 1 over square root for L1, 1 over square root for L2, and 0 for L3. And you can do the same here for 100, for 111, and you find these values. Yeah? Simply plug your C coefficients into these equations, yes? Your C values into this. Do the orientation value factor, and you find E111, 200 and about 250, E110 about 210, and E100 about 145. Conclusion, iron crystal is highly anisotropic in terms of properties, because it's going to be very stiff in the 111 direction, yes? Yes, and it's almost 100 gigapascal less stiff in the 100 direction. So from a principle's point of view, yes, the iron is not an isotropic material. Yes. However, yes. Again, if we come back to steel, and in practice, yeah, should we be really worried about this? Well, we should be worried about this when it's necessary. For instance, when you're doing calculations at the level of dislocations, for instance, or at the level of atoms. Yes, and you're trying to get some ideas of strains, yes, in the crystal, then you may want to worry about it. But at the level of the macro properties, it's different. So the single crystal elastic stress strain relations for ferrite, alpha iron, or austenite, gamma iron, you can basically ignore them. And you can use Hooke's law for isotropic solids, yes? Now, it's, of course, extremely interesting if you have lots of knowledge about the single crystals to use this knowledge to calculate the averaged properties, right? So to calculate an average modulus or an average shear modulus, yes? Using what you know about the single crystal properties, yes? Because the reason why we can actually think of steels as being isotropic, it's not because the single crystal is isotropic, it's because of the randomness of your small crystals in the microstructure, right? That takes away this anisotropy. So, and there are procedures to do this. And one of the procedures is to say, well, I have all the crystals are very random. Yeah? And when I strain them, all the crystals strain in the same way. Yes? And then you can do it, say, differently. You can say, well, no, when I strain them, the stresses on the crystals are the same, yes? And you don't get the same results when you say all the grains are stressed the same way or all the grains are strained the same way. Because if you say they're all strained the same way, then the stresses are unequally distributed. And if you say they're all stressed the same way, then all the strains are distributed randomly, differently. So the interesting thing is that these are two limiting cases. The right answer is somewhere in between. So, and I mean, it's a well-known problem, averaging problem in mechanics of crystals. Yes, and we have two averaging procedures. One is this isostrain procedure, which is also a void procedure. And the other one is the isostress or the Ruys procedure, yes? And so what you do is you basically calculate one extreme, other extreme, and then you average. You can use the arithmetic average, or you can use the geometric average. So the arithmetic average, you sum the two and you divide by two, or the geometric average, you multiply the two and you take the square root. Now you're going to ask me which one should I use. I'll tell you, you decide, because there's no rule to do this averaging. Yeah? And these are the equations. Yeah? So this is the for instance, if you want to calculate, say, the average single crystal, yes, shear modulus. For iron, you use this formula, yeah? And again, you see that you use the single crystal values here. Yeah? So this is the iso strain value, this is the iso stress value. You take these two values, divide by two, that gives you a very reasonable value for G, yes? Okay. Right. And because you know the temperature dependence of C11, C12, and C14, you also know the temperature dependence of these average properties, yes, and their compositional dependence also. So, for instance, here, this is mean average modulus, Young's modulus. This is mean average shear modulus for alpha iron. And this is the value here, the dotted line, for single crystal 110. Okay. Let's, if I have the E value of a material and the G value of a material, I can determine the bulk modulus. Yes, also. So, because everything is derived from these three independent parameters, I can calculate any other parameter, yes? And because I have their time temperature dependence, and I'll show you in a moment, we also have the compositional dependence, I can calculate them quite accurately using these equations. So B value is based on this, is very close to the value we had earlier, is 158 gigapascals. Okay, this is for alpha iron. This is for an austenitic stainless steel. You also see the temperature dependence for the Young's modulus, for the shear modulus, and the B value in this case, again using this equation that we have from elasticity theory, I get 154. So it's very close. Again, lattice of austenite is slightly less stiff, so you get a smaller B value. Okay. Now, something really interesting is with these parameters. And it's a concept, it's not a new concept, but it's an important concept for people that do calculations, in particular density functional calculations. And even though your elastic constants, like the bulk modulus, Poisson's ratio, the C11, C12, C44 elastic constant, they are parameters of the undeformed material, the elastically deformed material. There's no they're not related to plastic deformation, right? They're just related to straining the lattice a little bit. Yes, they are related in a subtle way to plastic deformation, in the sense that they relate to brittle or ductile fracture. And that the reason is because B is related to, here I write the steels, but you can write materials here, steels resistance to volume change. Yes, one of the compressibility. So if a material is very difficult to compress, yes, it will have an impact on the compressibility and the bulk modulus. So B is related to the resistance to volume change, to bond strength, and to fracture, right? Whereas G is related to the resistance of the material to shearing or deformation, yes? And the reason, and then as a consequence, the ratio of B over G, yes, and we'll see in a moment, and therefore Poisson's ratio are very closely connected to whether a material is brittle or ductile, even though these are elastic properties of the crystal. Yeah? And there is another parameter. C12 minus C44, yes, is related to the type of bonding. If this value is negative, the bonding is very directional. It's covalent. If this parameter C12 minus C44 is larger than zero, we have a more metallic type of bonding, non-directional bonding. These the idea of using these parameters to guess, to say something about ductility and brittleness of a crystal or of a material, yes, is based on, it's empirical. It's based on the study of many materials. You know, people find out, oh, look, you know, if a material is ductile, it tends to be in this range, the B over G value, or the C12 minus C44 tends to be in this range. But it works remarkably well, and so well that when people do DFT calculations and they want to say something, is material going to be intrinsically ductile or brittle, they'll say, well, look at the elastic parameters we calculated by DFT, and they'll say, well, we didn't do any plastic deformation. We know nothing about the dislocations. But because of these value, the value of these parameters, we guess it'll probably be a ductile material. And so what are these empirical rules? B over G smaller than 1.75, material tends to be brittle. B over G larger than 175, it tends to be ductile. So large B values, yes, means large resistance to strong bonds. Let's say, just put it this way, strong bonds. Small g values, easy deformation. Yes. So the larger this factor is, the better. Okay. So small g's, large b's. Ductile. In the case of alpha iron, we do b over g. We find 2.1 is larger. So we have, we can predict or guess it's going to be ductile. What about the other ductility brittleness parameter that's based on elasticity? So C12 minus C44 is negative, then it's brittle because of the type of bonding I have. C12 minus C44 larger than 0, it's ductile. For alpha iron, you make the difference, it's plus 15 gigapascal. Yeah? So material is just based on, if we only, we didn't know nothing about iron and we'd done some DFT calculations, which give us these parameters, we would have guessed, well, it's going to be mildly ductile, but certainly not brittle. Okay. So let's go one step further. So and highlight why Poisson ratio is so fundamental. Yes. So the Poisson ratio is this: you pull the material and you make the ratio of the thickness strain over the longitudinal strain. Yes. And this parameter, yes, can only have a value between minus 1 and plus a half. Yeah? And the reason why we know this is because, again, a Poisson ratio is an elastic property. So they're all interconnected, and you only have three independent parameters. Yeah? So you can write, there is a formula that you can write where, this is a very important formula, where the Poisson ratio is expressed as a function of the bulk modulus and the shear modulus. So this is the original equation. You can write it like this. It's 3 times this ratio minus 2 divided by 6 times the same ratio plus 2. And so, this value can be very large, infinitely large, say, or it can be zero, basically, not negative. So in the first case, Poisson's ratio is plus a half, and in the other case, it's minus 1. Okay, so in metals, this is the range, it's 0.2 to 0.4. Right, so now we can reuse this idea here, yes, to say, well, a material is brittle when the B over G ratio has a certain value. Well, this, of course, has, because B over G, the Poisson ratio has this dependence of the B over G ratio. We now see that the Poisson ratio is actually a fundamental parameter for brittleness or ductility in crystals, in materials. So so applying these two concepts to alpha iron, so here you have, let's say here first, this is the B over G ratio, and this is the difference between C12, C44. So we material is brittle if the y parameter here is negative, and this x parameter is smaller than 1.57. So this is any material that sits in this corner is brittle. Yes, alpha iron is here. Yes, it's definitely in the ductile area. In the case of the, I can represent the same ductility data in this G versus B graph. So here I have G values, B values, lines of constant B over G ratio are straight lines in this, yes? And of course, if I have a constant B over G value, I have a constant Poisson ratio, right? So here is B over G 1.75. That corresponds to a Poisson ratio of about 0.26. If I'm below here, yes, B over G is smaller than this. So I'm in the brittle area. That's this red area. Let's look at where alpha iron is. Well, we have a G that's about 80, remember, and a B that's around 150. Yes, so I'm right here, just very slightly above the brittle area. So purely on the basis of the elastic properties, we would conclude that irons and steels are, you know, we expect them to be ductile, but not extremely ductile. What this approach tells us, it tells us something fundamental about, you know, what to expect. But because it doesn't say anything about dislocations, which are ultimately responsible for plastic deformation, yes? And it doesn't tell us anything about strain hardening, yes? It tells us something fundamental, but it doesn't tell us the whole picture. Yeah? So we do need to look at plasticity of crystal, alpha iron and gamma iron crystals, to actually know how brittle or how ductile materials. Having said this, I didn't put this in this graph because I want to keep true to my promise that we only talk about iron and steel in this course. But if you would put on the same graph, you'd put other materials, you would indeed find that materials like, say, silicon, which is a very strong material, but very brittle, yes? All the semiconductors are here, yes? Lots of oxides are here. That very soft metals, like so gold and silver, are slightly above iron, etc. So it works remarkably well, these predictors of plasticity, or rather brittle ductile behavior in practice. Okay. And now, just to finish, in the material you will get, there are also a number of nice equations that you can use to compute shear modulus. When you do calculations with dislocations, yes, because dislocations are related to shape change, yes, the main parameters that playing a role, yes, here, is the shear modulus, yes? So you're interested in knowing what is the shear modulus of alpha iron or gamma iron. Their temperature dependence and their dependence composition. And so and these are very useful equations. So you have G value for alpha and for gamma as a function of temperature. You'll ask me, why? I don't really need this, right? Well, because I can measure it, right? I can say, well, I can measure, I can do a test, and I can, you know, measure my Young's modulus. I'm going to have to finish. Young's modulus, just in case some say, well, this is useless. You measure your elastic modulus, and you measure your Poisson ratio. You can do this in a routine test, right? And you'd be right. However, as I said in my introduction, in many cases, the phase in steels, the phase that you want to analyze or get the mechanical properties from, for instance, if you have a complex microstructure, that particular phase cannot be made macroscopically. Right? There are many situations where in steels where phases are stabilized by the fact that they're very small. Yes? And in that case, you know, if you want to predict the stress strain curve of your composite, yeah, you will need to have the shear modulus of that phase that you cannot measure in practice. And then it's very useful to have an equation like this. Of course, this is for pure iron. And then if you want to get the compositional effects, well, there you have them. This gives you the change of the modulus for ferrite, yes, and the change of the modulus in the case of austenite when it's alloyed. Yeah? So you, if you know your alloy composition, certain elements will increase the modulus. Other elements will decrease it. Yes, and the effect is, you can see that in austenite and in ferrite, the effect is broadly similar, but not always. As you see, for instance, here, there are elements such as chrome, which have a positive effect in ferrite, a negative effect in austenite. Yes? Okay. But you can use this, and so these two, the information on these two slides allow you to basically get a shear modulus, an average shear modulus of a phase as a function of temperature and for different compositions. Yeah? Okay, thank you very much. Excuse me for going a little bit over time, but it was nice to finish here. And so we'll meet on Monday. So I as I said, I put in the information, the slides on the e-class page. Let me know if you can access them.